Hello everyone, welcome to this lecture. In this lecture, today I will discuss about the vulnerability research and tools, what is incident response, and then I will discuss about phase of an incident response, and I also will discuss about the incident of response policies. First, we will discuss about the vulnerability research and tools. An important part of your toolkit as an ethical hacker will be the information gathered from vulnerability research. This process involves searching for and uncovering the vulnerabilities in system and determining their nature. The benefit of having this information is that an administrator or other personnel could use this information to opposite a position of defense. The information may also show where to place new resources or be used to planning monitoring. Vulnerability research, which is not the same as ethical hacking in that it passively uncovers security issues, whereas the process of ethical hacking actively looks for the vulnerabilities. Then, what is the incident response? As a penetration tester, your job is to provide information that will reduce the chance of a security breach or incident to the lowest possible level. But does a regular user have no responsibility? Absolutely not. Users have an important role to play as well. So, as a well-prepared individual, you must plan how you will react when a security incident occurs or follow the plans the company or clients provides to you. Planning ahead or knowing plans others have made will be beneficial because it will give you the edge when determining what to do after an incident and how to do it. One of the first things to keep in mind when thinking about incident response is the fact that you may very well be dealing with something that falls under the banner of crime, and such will require that you take special care. Responding to an incident to a computer crime can be particularly challenging and should be left to professionals because the evidence that need to be collected is intangible and can prevent a case from being prosecuted if you damage it. Before going too far, however, it is worth defining what is interfered by the term of computer crime. And the goal of computer crime can be anything that negatively impacts in some way, shape or form the operations of a company, individual or government. And by its very nature, computer crime does not discriminate against activities that are initiated via the internet or launched internally against a private network. And then the incident response policies, which is called IRP. The next detail that is important when considering incident responses is incident response policy. An IR specifies many details, but the following are usually always included. First, who will determine when and if a security incident has occurred? Which individuals and or departments are to be notified? The means through which they will be notified, who will be responsible for responding to the incident, and the appropriate response guideline. What you as a system administrator will be responsible for doing in the event of an accident. So, who will be involved in the incident or response process? This depends on the organization assessed, involved, and the overall security and severity of the situation. Several departments with an organization can work together, such as human resources, public relations, information technology, corporate security, and others. The idea is to get the appropriate personal and departmental involved in order to properly deal with the situation to at hand. The personnel involved can also determine which information can be released and to whom. For example, employees may not be privy to all the details of a security incident and may be informed only a need to know the basis. Typically, you will not be included in the development of this policy, but you will be included as someone who must follow it when the time comes and the incident has been declared by the person in charge. And now, we will discuss about the phase of an incident and response. There exist a number of phases in the incident response process. Each incident will traverse these phases as the incident occurs, evolves, and moves to its final resolutions. While an end user will not be truly aware of each of the phases of incident response, having some idea of the big picture may help you understand what you are doing and why you are being asked to do it. Each phase has distinct actions that take place within it, which you will learn more about as we move on. But for now, let's take a high-level look at the incident response process itself. So there is a list which is generally accepted by the National Institute of Standard and Technology, NIST, and others as the phase of the incident response. So first, the phase of the incident and response is response, and then the trials, and next the investigation, and next the containment and analysis and tracking, then recovery, then repair, and then debriefing and feedback. It is important to note that the actual phase described here many and may vary widely and widely between organizations because they fine-tune the incident response process to their own needs. You may work in an industry that is heavily regulated and that is has its own requirements that dictate to or a unique incident response process. As organizations grow in size and importance, it is likely that they will build or already have a group known as an incident response team. This team will comprise individuals who have the training and experience to properly collect the preserved evidence of a crime and the associated components with the response process. You may, depending on your experience and background, be asked to participate in these teams in the event an incident occurs. Of course, you will know ahead of time and be prepared so you are ready when and if the call overcomes. As part of the incident response team, you must be both properly trained and have the requisite experience to respond and investigate any security incident. And one of the components of incident response is the first individual to respond when an incident is reported. Once a security incident has been recognized and declared, it is vital that the team have a plan to follow. So I will discuss about this topic in my next lecture. So thank you. Hello everyone, welcome to this lecture. Today I will discuss about the ethical hacking. And first, we will discuss about the early days of hacking. The idea of hacking and hackers goes way back to the first technology enthusiasts who wanted to learn about new technology and were curious about how to it work. They are the same types of people who today are interested not only in acquiring all sorts of technology but also in learning how to customize the tweak it to do new things that the original designers never intended. In the early days, previous 1970, these hackers may have been found taking apart and learning about the inner workings of radios and early computers. As technology progressed, these individuals moved to more complex and advanced systems available at the time. Fast forward to the 1970s, and the mainframes that were present on college campuses and corporate environments are the target of interest by new generation of hackers. Later in the 1980s, the PC was the newest piece of technology, with hackers moving to this environment. In fact, 1980s saw hackers starting to engage in more malicious and the later malicious activities. Adding to the situation was the fact that their attacks could not now be used against many more systems because more people had access to PCs. In the 1990s, the internet was made accessible to public and system became interconnected. As a result, curiosity and mishaps could easily spread beyond a small collection of systems and go worldwide. Since 2000, smartphones, tablets, Bluetooth, and other technologies have been added to these devices and technologies that hackers target. As you can see, as technology evolves, so do hackers. attacks in response to what's available at the time. The current developments of hacking. In the early 2000s, more malicious activity started to appear in the form of more advanced attacks. In the first few years, the new millennium, the aggressiveness of attacks increased, with many attacks criminally motivated. Malicious attacks that have occurred include the following: the denial of service attacks, the manipulation of stock pieces attacks, identity theft, vandalism, credit card theft, privacy, theft of services. Among the many situations that have contributed to the increase in hacking and cybercrime are the amount of information being passed and the overall dependency on the internet and digital devices. Over the last decade, the number of financial transactions online has increased, creating a tempting target for crooks. Also, the openness of modern devices such as smartphones and technologies such as Bluetooth has made hacking and stealing information more prevalent. Now, the hacking, fun or criminal activity. As started earlier, hacking is by no means a new phenomenon. It has existed in one form or another since the 1960s. For only a portion of the time since then, hacking has been viewed as a crime and a situation that needs to be addressed. Let's look at some famous hackers over time. In 1988, the Cornell University student Robert T. Morris created what is considered to be the first internet worm. Due to an oversight in the design of the worm, it replicated extremely quickly, indiscriminately resulting in widespread slowdowns affecting whole internet. In 1994, Kevin Lee Paulson, going by the name Darknet, took over the telephone lines of the entire Los Angeles-based radio station KIIS-FM to ensure he would be the 102nd caller in order to win a Porsche 944 S2. And in 2001, Zenda Witt authored the Anna Korean Virus, which is designed to read all the entire entries of users' Outlook address book and email except to each. And the 2004, Adam Bodville, together with two friends, conspired to steal credit card information from the Lovis hardware chain. In 2009, Christina Vladimirovna, a young Russian hacker, got involved in several plots to defraud some of the largest banks in the United States and Great. The previous example represents some of the higher profile of incidents that moved awkward, but for every news item or story that makes it into the public consciousness, many more never do. Here are some generic examples of cybercrime: the stealing passwords and usernames of using vulnerabilities in a system to gain access fall and under the category of theft of accessing and the stealing of services and resources that the party would not otherwise be given access. Then the network intrusions are a form of a digital trespassing where a party goes some place that they would not otherwise have access to. The social engineering is both the simplest and the most complex form of hacking or exploiting a system by going after its weakest point and the human element. On the one hand, this is easy to attempt because the human being is many times the most accessible component of a system and the simplest to interact with. Posting and or transmitting illegal material has gotten to be a difficult problem to solve and deal with over the last decade. With the increased use of social media and the other internet related service, illegal material can spread from one corner of the globe to another in a very short period of time. The ransomware is the relatively newer class of malware that is designed to hunt down the encrypted file on a target system. The denial of service DOS and distributed denial of service DDoS attacks are ways to overload a system resources so it cannot provide the required services to legitimate users. And now we will discuss about the evolution and growth of hacking. As you will see in this course, attacks and strategies have improved and evolved over the years in ways you may not be aware of, and attackers have constantly sought to up their game with new tactics and strategies to include various types of malware such as worms, spam, spyware, adware, and even rootkits. Hackers have also started to realize that it is possible to use their skills to generate money and in many interesting ways. For example, attackers have used techniques to redirect web browsers to specific pages that generate revenue for themselves. Another example is a spammer sending out thousands upon thousands of email messages that advertise a product or service. Because sending out black emails cost mere pennies, it takes only a small number of purchases to make a nice profit. The field you are entering or may already be working in as a security administrator or engineering is one that changes rapidly. In this field, attacker and defender are in an ongoing struggle to gain dominance. Because attackers have become highly flexible and adaptable, so must you be. As an ethical hacker, your ability to think outside the box will serve you well as you envision new strategies and potential attacks before they are used against you. In this course, you will learn these methods and what is being used on the front lines to perpetrate increasingly complex and devastating attacks. You must be aware of how these attacks have evolved, how technology has played a part, and how the law is dealing with an ever more complicated landscape. You will also learn more about the motivations of attackers and their mindset. This is one of the challenges that you will have as an ethical hacker, understanding and empathizing with your attackers. Understanding the motivation can, in some cases, yield valuable insight into why a given attack has been committed or maybe the committed against an assist. For now, you should keep in mind that an attacker needs three things to carry out a crime: means or the ability to carry out their goals or aims, which in essence means that they have the skills and abilities needed to complete the job, the motive or the reasons to be pursuing the given goal, opportunity or the opening or weakness needed to carry out the threat at a given time. So this is for today. Everyone, welcome to this lecture. Today's lecture is about understanding the step of ethical hacking. So in this lecture, you will begin to process of investigating a system with the intention of attacking and compromising the target. You will start the process with the step known as footprinting, which could be generally termed doing your homework regarding your target. Footprinting is a vital first step in the process of penetration testing because it allows for the gathering of information both passively and actively about your intended target of evaluation. Spending a good amount of time learning about your target before you start launching attacks and strike against it will allow for more precise targeting and more accurate and productive actions. In addition, taking time to gain information and plan your next steps, it will allow you to be more steady rather than running the headlock into the process. For an overview of this process, let's look at the steps of ethical hacking to see where footprinting fits in as well as what future phases hold. First phase is footprinting. Footprinting is the first phase of the ethical hacking process and is the subject of this lecture. This phase consists of passively and actively gaining information about a target. The goal is to gather as much information as is reasonable and useful about a potential target with the objective of getting enough information to make later attacks more accurate. The end result should be a profile of the target. This is a raw picture, but now that gives enough data to plan the next phase of scanning. Information that can be gathered during this phase include the following. In footprinting, this is the IP address range, namespace, employee information, phone numbers, facility information, job information. Footprinting takes advantage of the information that is carelessly exposed or disposed of inadvertently. Phase 2 is scanning. Scanning is which focus on an active engagement of the target with the intention of obtaining more information. Scanning the target network will ultimately locate active host that can then be targeted in a later phase. Footprinting helps identify potential targets, but not all may be viable or active host. Once scanning determines which hosts are active and what the network looks like, a more refined process can be placed. During this phase, tools such as this are used: pings, ping sweeps, port scans, and the tracer. And next, the other steps of the phase of this footprinting is enumeration. The last phase before you attempt to gain access to a system is the enumeration phase. Enumeration is the systematic probing of a target with the goal of obtaining user list, routing tables, and protocol from the system. This phase represents a significant shift in your process. It is the initial transition from being on the outside looking into moving to the inside of the system to gather data. Information such as shares, user groups, applications protocols, and banners all proves useful in getting to know your target, and this information is carried forward into the attack phase. The information gathered during phase 3 typically includes, but is not limited, the following: first, the usernames, group information, passwords, hiding shares, device information, network layout, protocol information, service data, and service information. In the phase 4, there is system hacking. Once you have completed the first 3 phases, you can move into the system hacking phase. You will recognize that things are getting much more complex and that the system hacking phase cannot be completed in a single pass. It involves a methodological approach that includes cracking passwords, escalating privileges, executing applications, hiding files, covering tracks, concealing evidence, and then pushing into a complex attack. And then now we'll discuss about what is enumeration. Enumeration is the process of extracting information from a target system to determine mode of configuration and environment represent. In many cases, it is possible to extract information such as username, machine names, shares, and service from a system, as well as the other information, depending on the OS itself. So, why initiative active connections to a target? Simply put, it is the only way to learn additional information on top of what we gathered so far through footprinting and scanning. So these active connections, we can now execute directed queries at a host, which will extract much additional information. Having retrieved sufficient information, we can better assess the strengths and weakness of the system. Information gathered during the phase generally follows into the following types: the network resource and shares, user and groups, routing tables, auditing and service setting, machine names, application and banners, SNMP and DNS details. And so, what options are available to an attack performing enumeration? Let's look at the techniques you will be using in this lecture. And this extracting information from email IDs. This technique is used to obtain username and domain name information from an email address or ID. Obtaining information through default passwords, using brute force attacks on directory services, exploiting SNMP, exploiting SMTP, working with DNS zone transfers, capturing user groups, retrieving system policy setting. So in by this step, you will performing enumeration. And using brute force attacks on a directory service is a database that contain information used to administer the network. As much it is a big target for an attacker looking to gain extensive information about an environment. Many directories are vulnerable to put verification deficiencies as well as the other holes that may be exploited for the purpose of discovering and compromising user accounts. And the working with DNS zone transfer, a zone transfer is DNS is a normal occurrence, but when the this information falls into the wrong hands, the effect can be devastating. A zone transfer is designed to update DNS servers with the correct information. However, the zone contains information that could map out the network, providing valuable data about the structure of the environment. Hello everyone, welcome to this lecture. Today's lecture is about scanning. First, what is scanning? Scanning is a process that involves engaging and probing a target network with the intent of revealing useful information and then using that information for later phase of the pen test. Armed with the knowledge of network fundamentals, a scanner, and the results of throughout the footprinting, it is possible to get a decent picture of a target. The types of scan. Not all scan will be looking for the same thing or attempting to achieve the same result. So it is important that you understand what your options are going into the process. All scan share the same general theme, which is to gain information about a host or group of hosts. But if you dig a little deeper, difference start to emerge. Each scan will provide a different level and type of information than the others, and thus each will provide some value to you. To keep things simple, let's break the types of scans into three different categories. First, the port scan, the network scan, and the vulnerability scan. The port scan. Port scanning is the process of sending carefully crafted messages or packets to a target computer with the intent of learning more about it. These probes are typically associated with well-known port numbers or those less than or equal to 124. And more than likely, when the topic of scanning is mentioned, this is the type of scan many think of. While many different scanners on the market perform the same task, that Nmap is far and away the most frequently used. Next, the network scan. Network scanning is designed to locate all the live hosts on a network. This type of scan will identify those systems that may be attacked later or those that may be scanned a little more closely. Scans that fit into this category are those such as a ping switch, which rapidly scan a range of IPs and determine if an address has a port on host attached or to it or not. The vulnerability scan. A vulnerability scan is used to identify weakness or vulnerabilities on a target system. This type of scan is quite commonly done as a proactive measures, with the goal of catching problems internally before an attacker is able to locate those same vulnerabilities and act on them. A typical vulnerability scan will discover host access points and open ports, analyze service responses, classify threats, and generate reports. Vulnerability scans are popular with companies because they can perform them on their own quite easily to access their systems. Two commonly used vulnerability scanners include the Tenable Nessus and the Rapid7 Nexpose. In addition, there are specialized scanners such as Burpsuit, Nikto, and WebInspect. And now we will discuss about the sniffers. First, before discussing the sniffers, we have to know the sniffers. Now we will discuss about the understanding sniffers. Sniffers are utilities than you, as an ethical hacker can use to capture and scan traffic moving across a network. Sniffers are a broad category that encompasses any utility that has the ability to perform a packet capturing function. Regardless of the build, sniffers perform the traffic capturing function by enabling the promiscuous mode on the connected network interface, thereby allowing the capture of all traffic, whether or not the traffic is intended for them. Once an interface enters promiscuous mode, It doesn't discriminate between traffic that is destined for its address. It picks up all traffic on the wire, thereby allowing you to capture and investigate very packet. Sniffing can be active or passive in nature. Typically, passive sniffing is considered to be any type of sniffing where traffic is looked at but not altered in any way. Essentially, passive sniffing means listening only. In active sniffing, not only is traffic monitored, but it may also be altered in some way as determined by the attacking party. Most sniffer utilities have basic options that are fairly consistent across the gamut of versions. This consistency holds true regardless of whether it's a Linux-based utility or a Windows version. We'll dig more into types and specific later, but first let's look at the commonalities. On most sniffers, a main pane displays the incoming packets and highlights or lists them accordingly. It is usually linear in its listing unless you specify otherwise via filters or other options. In addition, there is commonly a subpanel that allows an in-depth view of the packet selected. It's important to be familiar with your sniffer of choice because it will save you a lot of time and frustration in the long run. Also, having a good grasp of a sniffer basic functions will allow you to use many different sniffers without too many problems. So from here, a sniffer usually has an interface selection or activation option that begins the capture phase. Once you choose the capture button, you should see packets populating your capture pane. If not, check your network interface selection. All sniffers give you the ability to select from all available interfaces on your computer. You can easily choose a disconnect interface and sit there irritated because your sniffer is not working. Just double check and you will happily reward it with real life traffic. Now we will discuss about the understanding session of hijacking. Session hijacking is synonymous with a stolen session in which an attacker intercepts and takes over a legitimately established session between a user and a host. The user-host relationship can apply to access of any authentic resource, such as a web browser, talent session, or other TCP-based connection. Attackers place themselves between the user and host, thereby letting them monitor user traffic and launch specific attacks. Once a successful session hijack has occurred, the attacker can either assume the role of the legitimate user of the simple monitor the traffic for opportune times to inject or collect specific packets to create the desired effect, like this one. So, illustrate a basic session hijack. In its most basic sense, a session is an agreed upon period of time under which the connected state of the client and server is vetted and authenticated. This simply means that both the server and the client know who each other are, and based on this knowledge, they can trust that data sent either way will end up in hands of the appropriate party. If a session hijack is carried out successfully, what is the danger? Several events can take place at this point, including identity theft and the data corruption. In other situations, session hijacks have made for a perfect mechanism through which someone can sniff tariff or record transactions. Understanding what constitutes a session makes it easy to see how session hijacking can be extremely effective when all supporting factors are set up correctly. Many of the prerequisite setup factors involved in session hijacking have already been discussed in the previous section. For example, a specific form of hijacking involves using a sniffer both prior to the during an attack, and you learned about sniffers in the previous sections. So you learned about the TCP/TOS handshake, which will greatly aid your understanding of TCP session hijacking. Before we get too deeply into the details of each attack, let's look how session hijacking is categorized. An attacker carrying out a session hijack is seeking to take over a session for their own needs. Once they have taken over a session, they can then go about stealing data, issuing commerce, or even committing transactions that they wouldn't be able to otherwise. So we will explore the various forms of session hijacking in the next lecture. So this is for today. Thank you everyone. Hello everyone, welcome to this lecture. This lecture is about the DOS and the other thing. First we will discuss about the DOS. Denial of service is an attack that aims at preventing normal communication with a resource by disabling the resource itself or by disabling an infrastructure device providing connectivity to it. The disabled resource could be in the form of customer data, website, resource or specific services. To name a few, this most common form of DOS is to flood a victim with so much traffic that all available resources of the system are overwhelmed and unable to handle additional requests. The attackers flood the victim network with extremely large amounts of useless data or data requests, thereby overwhelming the network and rendering it useless or unavailable to legitimate users. So what are the signs of the potential DOS attacks? Here are a few things about which may indicate that a DOS attack is ineffective. The unavailable of a resource, the loss of access to a website, slow performance, increase in spam emails. Typically, victim of DOS attacks range from governmental owned resources to online vendors and others, and the intent of the attack is usually the deciding factor in terms of which target will be engaged. Consider a few simple examples to give you an idea of the impact of a successful DOS attack. From a corporate perspective, if the focus is always on the bottom line, a successful DOS attack against a corporation's web page or availability of back-end resource could easily result in a loss of millions of dollars in revenue, depending on company size. Also, consider the negative impact to the brand name and the company reputations. As you can see, the impact of a single DOS attack with specific directions intent can prove extremely damaging to the victim on many different levels. Another level that prevents DOS attacks as well as other attacks from is hackers who take action against a target based on the principle or a sense of personal mission, which is known as the hacktivism. Hacktivists are a particularly concerning threat because their focus is not necessarily on a personal gain or recognition. Their success is measured by how much as their malicious actions benefit their cause. This thought process ties in nicely with DOS attacks in that the message being sent can be left up to interpretations or more commonly by claiming by a group or individual. And now we will discuss about the what is social engineering. Social engineering is a term that is widely used but poorly understood. It is generally defined as any type of attack that is non-technical in nature and that involves some type of human interaction with the goal of trying to trick or coerce a victim into revealing information or violate normal security practices. So social engineers are interested in gaining information they can use to carry out actions such as identity theft or stealing passwords or in finding out information for later use. If it helps, you can think of social engineers in the same context as the con artist. Typically, individuals who engage in this type of activity are very good at recognizing the telltale signs of or behaviors that can be useful in extracting information, such as the following: the moral obligations. An attacker may prey on a victim's desire to provide assistance because they feel compelled to do so out of a sense of duty. The trust. Human beings have an inherent tendency to trust others. Social engineers exploit a human tendency to trust by using buzzwords or other means. In the case of buzzwords, for example, use a familiar terms may lead a victim to believe that an attacker has insider knowledge of a project or place. Threats. A social engineer may threaten a victim if they do not comply with a request. something for nothing. The attacker may promise a victim that for little or no work, they will trap tremendous rewards. The ignorance. The reality is that many people do not realize the dangers associated with social engineering and don't recognize it as a threat. And now we will discuss about the cryptography, the early application and example, history of cryptography. Cryptography are early application and example. So what is cryptography? Why should you even care? I will see if I can answer these questions by looking at the body of knowledge and exploring its depths. Cryptography deals with protection and preservation of information in all its forms. This science has evolved dramatically over time, but its underlying goal has never changed. Even though the tools have, as information has changed and human beings and have gotten smarter, the technology has become substantially more advanced to keep up with changing issues and threats. If you look back in time and trace the evolution of the science up to the current day, you will see that technology in the form of increasingly powerful computers has made the process more complex and innovation as well as stronger. The crypton analysis is an old science that has been around as long as people have been trying to keep things secret. The history of cryptography. I know you purchase this lecture not for history lessons but for information on how to become an ethical hacker. Yet you can learn things by studying the history of cryptography, which can help you relate to the techniques a little better. Early cultures taught us that cryptography is a simple technique or group of techniques used to protect information. The primitive techniques of time past may look antiquated and simple in the face of today's complex and mind-numbling technologies, but the basic concepts had not changed. Cryptography is far from being a new technology and has existed for a very long time. The strong story goes back to at least 4,000 years, if not longer. Along the way, many different systems have been developed, with some falling out of favor while others evolved into the different forms. Let's look at some the early applications about cryptography. First, the encrypted patterns glyphs used in Egyptian hieroglyphics were commonly used for the spiritual and the religious reason. The ancient Egyptians were probably using the system not so much in withhold secrets, but because they wanted a special writing system to commune with their gods and eternity. It is believed that the only members of the royal family and the religion's order could fully understood how to read and write the systems and comprehend it fully. And in 1799, a sense discovery in the sands of Egypt by the French army uncovered something that would be instrumental in decoding the language. The Rosetta Stone was the key that allowed modern civilization to understand a language that was nearly lost. So it took over 20 years of concerted efforts to reveal the language to the world once, and which is now kept in the British Museum. But moreover, 20 years they cannot explain the language. They can explain the small few things of this Rosetta Stone. So in my next lecture, I will explain the cryptography more and deeply. So wait for this lecture. Thank you, everyone. Hello everyone. Welcome to this lecture. Today I'll discuss about what is social engineering, and then I'll discuss about the why does social engineering work. First, the why. What is the social engineering? Social engineering is a term that is widely used but poorly understood. It's generally defined as any type of attack that is non-technical in nature and that involves some type of human interaction with the goal of trying to trick or coerce a victim into revealing information or violate normal security practices. Social engineers are interested in gaining information they can use to carry out actions such as identity theft or stealing passwords, or in finding out information for later use. Scams may include trying to make a victim believe the attacker is technical support or someone in authority. An attacker may dress a certain way with the intent of fooling the victim into thinking the person has authority. The end goal of each approach is for the victim to drop their guard or for the attacker to gain enough information to better coordinate and plan in later work. If it helps, you can think of social engineers in the same context as con artists. Typically, individuals who engage in this type of activity are very good at recognizing telltale signs of behaviors that can be useful in extracting information, such as the following. The moral obligation: an attacker may prey on a victim's desires to provide assistance because they feel compelled to do so out of sense of duty. Then trust: human beings have an inherent tendency to trust others. Social engineers exploit a human tendency to trust by using buzzwords or other means. In the case of buzzwords, for example, use of familiar terms may lead a victim to believe that an attacker has insider knowledge of a project or place. The threats: a social engineers may threaten a victim if they do not comply with a request, something for nothing. The attackers may promise a victim that for little or no work, they will reap the tremendous rewards. The ignorance: the reality is that many people do not realize the dangers associated with the social engineering and don't recognize it as a threat. So now we will discuss about the why does social engineering works. Social engineering is effective for a number of reasons, each of which can be remedied for exploit depending on whether you are the defender or the attacker. Let's take a look at each. A lack of technological fix. Let's face it, technological can do a lot to fix problems and address security, but at the same time, it can be source of weakness. One thing that technology has little or no impact on this, blunting the effectiveness of social engineering. This is largely because technology can be circumvented or configured incorrectly by the human beings. And then the insufficient security policies. The policies that state how information, resources, and other related items should be handled are often incompetent, insufficient at best. The difficult detection. Social engineering, by its very nature, can be hard to detect. Think about it. An attack against technology may have tracks in a log file or trip and detention system IDS, but social engineering probably won't. A lack of training. Lack of training or insufficient training about social engineering and how to recognize it can be a big source of problem. In many of the class discussed in this course and lectures, you have seen social engineering play a role. One such example is that of Trojans, which exploit social engineering to entice a victim to open an executable or attachment that is infected with malware. A Trojan is a piece of malware that relies primarily on the element of a social engineering as a mechanism to start an infection. Using the social engineering aspect, various writers can entice an unsuspecting victim into executing malware with the promise of giving them something they expect or want. And now we will discuss about the understanding DOS, denial of service in attack, that aims to preventing normal communication with a resource by disabling the resource itself or by disabling an infrastructure device, preventing connectivity to it. The disabled resource could be in the form of customer data, website resources, or specific services, to name a few. The most common form of DOS is to flood a victim with so much traffic that all available resources of the system are overwhelmed and unable to handle additional requests. The attacker floods the victim networks with extremely large amount of useless data or data requests, thereby overwhelming the network and rendering it useless or unavailable to legitimate users. So what are the signs of a potential DOS attack? Here are a few that may indicate that a DOS attack is in effect. The unavailability of the resource, loss of access to a website, slow performance, increase in spam emails. Typical victims of DOS attacks range from government-owned resources to online vendors and others, and the intent of the attack is usually the deciding factor in terms of which target will be engaged. Consider a few simple examples to give you an idea of the impact of a successful DOS attack from a corporate perspective. The focus is always on the bottom line. A successful DOS attack against a corporation's webpage or availability of a back-end resource could easily result in a loss of millions of dollars in revenue, depending on the company size. And also consider the negative impact to the brand name and the company reputation. As you can see, the impact of a single DOS attack with specific directed intent can prove extremely damaging to the victim on many different levels. Another theme that pervades DOS attacks as well as other attacks from is hackers who take action against a target based on principle or a sense of personal mission, which is known as hacktivism. Hacktivists are a particularly connecting threat because their focus is not necessarily on personal gain or recognition. Their success is measured by how much their malicious actions benefit their cause. This thought process ties in nicely with DOS attacks in that the message being sent can be left up to interpretation or more commonly be claimed by a group of individual or a group of individuals. So this is for this lectures. Thank you everyone. Hello everyone, welcome to my lecture. Today's lecture is about footprinting, scanning, then enumeration, then system hacking and password cracking. So first we will discuss about the footprinting. In the previous course I have already discussed about footprinting, scanning and enumeration. In this lecture I again will discuss about the footprinting, scanning and enumeration. So first the footprinting. Footprinting is the first step in this process and simply involves gathering as much information as you possibly can about a target. You are looking for information pertaining to the whole organization, including technology, people, policies, facilities, network information, and anything else that may seem useful. Footprinting helps you understand the organization, create a profile that you can use for later stages for your attack, and plan an offensive strategy. Information you gather during this phase may include the following: the namespace, employee information, phone numbers, facility information, job information. Footprinting shows you the amount of information that is left lying on the table by most organizations during your exploration. You learn that you can acquire a significant amount of data from various sources, both common and uncommon. Now the scanning. When you moved on from footprinting, you transitioned into the scanning phases. Scanning is focused on gathering information from a network with the intention of locating active host. You identify host for the purpose of attack and in order to make a security assessment as needed. You can find information about target systems over the internet by using public IP addresses. In addition of addresses, you also try to gather information about services running on each host. During this phase, you use techniques such as this, as pings, ping sweeps, port scans, and tracer. Some of the process you use unmask or uncover varying levels of detailing about the services. You can also use inverse scanning techniques that allow you to determine which IP addresses from the range you uncovered during the footprinting do not have a corresponding live host behind them. And now we will discuss about the enumeration. The last phase before you attempting to gain access QoS system is enumeration. The enumeration, as you have observed, is the systematic probing of a target with a goal of the obtaining information such as user list, routing tables, and protocols from the system. Information about shares, users, groups, applications, protocols, and banners can prove the useful in getting to know your target. So, the attacker seeks to look at items such as users and groups data that let them remaining under the radar longer. Enumeration involves making many more active connections with the system than during previous phases. Once you reach this phase, the possibility of detection is much higher. So, the information gathered during this phase typically includes but is not limited to the following: username, group information, passwords, hidden shares, device information, network layout, protocol information, service data, and service information. Now, the system hacking. Once you have completed the first three phases, now you can move into the system hacking phase. At this point, the process becomes much more complex. You can't complete the system hacking phase in a single pass. It involves using a methodical approach that includes cracking passwords, scaling privileges, executing applications, hiding files, covering tracks, concealing evidence, and then pushing into a more involved attack. Remember that the system hacking process typically does not involve you gaining access in one stroke. In fact, gaining access to a system is kindly of like tunneling under a wall. The process is gradual and can be time consuming depending on how deep and elaborate you want to be, but it will eventually yield results. You will find that you will gain access to greater and greater degrees until you eventually have the level of access that you need to accomplish the task that you have in mind. Let's look at the system hacking process, starting with one of the better known steps is password cracking. Now we will discuss about the password cracking. In this enumeration phase, you collect a wealth of information including usernames. These usernames are important now because they give you something on which to focus your attack more closely. You use password cracking to obtain the credential of a given amount with the intention of using the amount account to gain authorized access to the system under the guise of the legitimate users. To fully grasp why password cracking is a popular first step in gaining access, let's first look at the function of password. A password is designed to be something an individual can remember easily, but at the same time, not something that can be easily guessed or broken. This is where the problem lies. Human beings tend to choose passwords that are easy to remember, which can make them easy to guess. Although choosing passwords that are easier to remember is not a bad thing, it can be a liability if individuals choose passwords that are too simple to guess. Here are some examples of passwords that lend themselves to cracking. Password that use only numbers, password that use only letters, password that are all upper or lower case, password that use proper names, password that use dictionary words, short passwords fewer than 8 characters. In general, following the rules for creating a strong password is a good line of defense against the attacks we'll expose. Many companies already employ these rules in the form of password requirements or complexity requirement, but let's examine them in the interest of being complete. Typically, when a company is writing policy or performing training, they will have a document guideline or statement that says to avoid the following: password that contain only letter, special characters and numbers that may be the STUD at 52, and password that contain only numbers like 2345678 9 or 2369 8 1 2 7, and password that contain only special characters and like the and hashtag, the multiplication number, at the rate, the exclamatory, and the percent, and also the password that contain only letters and numbers like meet 123, or password that contain only letter. the POTHMYDE and passwords that contain only letters special characters like Rex at and BA. Passwords that contain only special characters and numbers 123 at the rate the dollar sign and 4. Users who select passwords that contain patterns that adhere to any of these points on this list are more vulnerable to most of the attacks we will discuss for recovering passwords. So everyone, this is for today. Thank you. Hello everyone, welcome to this lecture. Today I will discuss about the SQL injection. So first I will introduce you with the SQL injection. So SQL injection has been around for at least 20 years, but it is no less powerful or dangerous than any other attack we have covered so far. It is designed to exploit flaws in a website or the web applications. The attack works by inserting code into an existing line of code prior to its being executed by a database. If SQL injection is successful, attackers can cause their own code to run. In the real world, this attack has proven dangerous because many developers are either not aware of the threat or don't understand its seriousness, and it in some cases don't even know how to defend against it. Developers should be aware of the following. SQL injection is typically a result of flaws in the web applications or website and is not an issue with the database. SQL injection is the source of many of the high-level or well-known attacks on the internet. The goal of attacks of this type is not submit commands through a web application to a database in order to retrieve or manipulate the data. The usual cause of this type of flaw is important and improper of absence input validation, those allowing code to pass unimpeded to the database without being verified. From the attacker side, vulnerabilities to SQL injection is very easy to detect. Visiting a suspect site and getting it to generate errors message can indicate a potential vulnerability to this type of attack. In addition, the vulnerability of automated and effective tools has increased, setting the bar even lower for successful execution of the attack. And in the following example, an attacker with username link insert their name after the equal sign following the where owner, who is used to include the string name delete from items for it name into an existing SQL command, and the query becomes following the queries is like this one. And then many of the common database products such as Microsoft SQL Server and Oracle's Sable allow several SQL statements separated by the semicolon to the executed were at once. And in other databases, this technique will generate an error and fail. So knowing the database you are attacking is essential. In an attack, enter this string name delete from items select from items where the following three valid statements will be created like this one. So a good way to prevent SQL injection attacks is to use input validation, and which ensures that the only approved characters are accepted. Use whitelist, which detects safe characters, and blacklist, which detects the unsafe characters. Now we will discuss about the result of SQL injection. What can be accomplished as a result of a SQL injection attack? Well, there are huge number of possibilities, which are limited only by the configuration of the system and the skill of the attacker. If an attack is successful, a host of problems could result. Consider the following a sample of the potential outcomes. The identity spoofing through manipulating database to insert debugs and bogus or the misleading information such as email address and contact information. The alteration of price in e-commerce applications. In this attack, the intruder once again alters data but does so with the intention of changing price information in order to purchase products or services at a reduced rate. Alteration of data or outright replacement of data in existing database with information created by the attacker. And the escalation of privilege to increase the level of access an attacker has to the system up to and the including full administrative access to the operating system. Denials of service performed by flooding with the server with request designed to overwhelm the system, and the data extraction and disclosure of all data on the system through the manipulation of that database. Destruction or corruption of data through the rewriting, alternating or other means, eliminating or altering transactions that have been or will be committed. And then the anatomy of a web applications. First, a web application is the target of a SQL injection attack. So you must understand how these apps work. A web app can be described simply as an application that is accessed through a web browser or applications. However, we need to be a little more detailed with our description for you to better understand the SQL injection. In essence, a web application works by performing these steps. The user makes a request through the web browser from the internet to the web server. The web server accepts the request and forwards to the applicable web application server. The web application server performs the requested task. The web application accesses the entire database available and responds to the web server. The web server responds to the user once the transaction is complete. The requested information appears on the user's monitor. The details involved in the steps can change depending on the applications involved. So the server side vs client side technologies. First, let's look at the type of technologies involved in browsing and working with the web. Then, mainly fall into two areas, client-side and server-side technologies. Server-side technologies are those that run and are executed on the server itself before delivering information to the requester. Client-side technologies are those that run within the browser or somewhere on the client-side. For the purpose of our discussion, we will not be covering client-side technologies here. Server-side technologies come in many varieties and types, each of which offers something specific to the users. Generally, each of the technologies allows the creation of dynamic data-driven web applications. You can use a wide range of server-side technologies to create this type of web applications. Among them are the following: the ASP, ASP.NET, Oracle, PHP, JSP, SQL Server, IBM DB2, MySQL, Ruby on Rails. All of these technologies are powerful and offer the ability to generate web applications that are extremely versatile and It also has vulnerabilities that can lead to it being compromised. But this in my the next lecture is not this lecture is not about those. This lecture is like SQL injection is designed to target the code that is used to make the technologies access a database as part of its functioning. This code, when incorrectly crafted, can be scrutinized and result in the vulnerabilities being uncovered and exploited. It may seem as exploiting vulnerabilities in code is an easy thing to do, but in reality it is nowhere near an easy task. In this case of SQL injection, understanding the known case and the intricacies is a key to talking advantages, weaknesses and flaws in code. So thank you everyone.